Department of Mathematics Colloquium, and the second, at the same time, talk of the Dynamical Systems and the Related Topics workshop. Our speaker today is Konstantin Khanin from University of Toronto and the Landau Institute?
Not anymore. Well, maybe it's a gray area.
Gray area, okay. He will speak on renormalization and rigidity. And unlike other talks, it's 60 minutes.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's first time here. It's a real pleasure to be here. So many friends, familiar faces. And I was told it's colloquium, so it's going to be elementary at the beginning, and I hope up to the very end, we'll see. I gave a title very general, Renormalization and Rigidity. I hesitated whether to say in dynamics or not, decided not. And because of that, I will start with examples of renormalization not from dynamics, just to show where everything comes from. But first, let me write these keywords which we'll be explaining during this talk. So the keyword is, of course, renormalization. And then somehow related word, universality. And then rigidity. And by the end of the talk, I will kind of explain relations between them. But I'll start with a history of how ideas of renormalization appear, first was studied. And maybe renormalization first originated from quantum field theory, but the major impact was in statistical mechanics in the 60s, where ideas of universality and renormalization first were realized and were used as a tool in real physics, and there is a it was a Nobel Prize given to Wilson for developing the idea of renormalization, although he was not the founder of this idea, but he was the only one who got this medal. It was kind of controversy regarding that. Some people were upset, but he developed it as a tool. And I'm not going to this physics and statistical mechanics significantly, but I'll give you just very elementary flavor of what's going on there. So I will start with central limit theorem, which is a very basic result in probability theory, right? So we start with sums of independent, identically distributed random variables. So we have psi 1, psi 2, and so on. And we'll assume that they are IID. We also assume that mean value is equal to 0, and we assume that second moment is 1. And then, of course, everybody knows that if we consider some of these random variables up to n, and then normalize on square root of n, then distribution of this random variable converges as n goes to infinity to normal distribution with mean value 0 and variance 1. And this is central limit theorem. Now, if you want to look at this central limit theorem from a point of view of renormalization, what you'll do? You just split this sum into two parts. You consider psi 1 plus 1 plus psi n over 2. You assume n is even. It's not essential. And then psi n over 2 plus 1. And so on. Psi n. You normalize on square root of a number of terms here, so you normalize the square root of n over 2, and this is square root of n over 2. You still have to divide by 1 over square root of 2 to have exactly the same expression as here. And then you look at it and you think, okay, if this converges to something, and I don't know if it's Gaussian or not yet, if it converges to something, then this is very close to this something already, and this is very close to something. The same thing, the same distribution. So it means that if I take one random variable, zeta, with some law, and then take convolution of it, so which means that sum is independent copy of the same random variable, eta, And then normalize this. This is zeta, this is eta. Normalize the square root of 2. Then the law of this thing should be the same as what we started from. And that's the only possibility for the law which you have here, if you don't know this is normal distribution. The only possibility that you would have something convoluted with the same thing divided by square root of 2 should have the same law. You can look at it slightly different. You can think that what is written here is a map from a space of probability distribution to the space of probability distribution. So we start with probability distribution of zeta, which is the same as zeta, and then we take this probability distribution, and that's the result of our map. So we get map R from a space of probability distributions into itself. So we get infinite dimensional dynamical system, a map, on just concrete map. And what we just said, that if there is a possibility of having limited here, then the limit must be a fixed point for this map. So it should satisfy the property that if we take R applied to this law, and then we denote this law F, then you get the same law. So a fixed point of the set. Okay, we'll discuss what are the fixed points for this map in a moment, but you also want to have that if you start from something nearby, you converge to the same thing. So you want also to have this fixed point to be stable, or almost stable, have not too many unstable directions, ideally stable. So what does it mean? You have to linearize it, take Frischer derivative, linearize it in some functional space, at this fixed point, and then you want to say that this is contraction. Doesn't have a stable direction, this linear operator. That's your program. Now, it's trivial to carry on this program if you know what is a, if you use Fourier transform, if you know what is a characteristic function. So, if I denote the characteristic function of this law f, well, not fixed point, but any law to which I apply this operator, if I denote, so I take e to the I lambda eta and take average value of it, this will be functioned on lambda, this is characteristic function. Then in terms of characteristic function, of course, convolution is a very simple object. You just take product square of the thing and you normalize on square root of 2 because of this square root of 2. And you want this to be equal to g on lambda. And of course, you immediately can see that if you take e to the minus lambda square, then it works. This is a fixed point. If you take square, it will be 2, and then it divides 2 divided by 2, you get exactly the same thing. So you get characteristic function of Gaussian law, which you can recognize, so you can take inverse Fourier transform and get Gaussian distribution. So this is a fixed point. It's not the only fixed point, but it's a fixed point. Fine. Now, what about stability of this fixed point? Well, what means stability? It means that you consider some probability distribution with this characteristic function, you perturb it a little bit, right? So you consider Fourier transform, which would have form this plus small epsilon times some function h on lambda. And then you apply your transformation to the thing, and you want to get that it will be e to the minus lambda square as a main term, because it's almost fixed point, plus epsilon, maybe multiplied by something, and then it's an eigenfunction of the same h on lambda, maybe with some mu, which is eigenvalue. Now, how to get this work? Well, it's quite clear that if I take polynomial here, so if I consider epsilon times lambda to the k, then what I do is just take product of the thing, so I've got e to the minus 2 lambda square, and here we have 1 plus 2 epsilon lambda to the k. I ignore plus terms of higher order. So that's what I get if I apply my
k.
Say it again. K is the power of this polynomial.
But why?
Just any power. 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
I try it.
Okay.
And then I get this expression. And I immediately see that if I divide it by square root of 2, lambda over square root of 2, then I have exactly the same expression I started from, but the mu will be epsilon, and then I would have 2 divided by 2 in power k, lambda to the k, plus higher terms. So yes, indeed, this perturbation is an eigenfunction for my operator. It preserved its form up to first order Neptune, and eigenvalue for lambda to the k, if you consider this eigenfunction, the eigenvalue mu, depending on k, of course, is equal to this expression, 2 over 2 to the k. Sorry?
Yeah, 2 to the k over 2.
2 over, what I have here?
Square root of 2
root to the k. 2 to the k over 2. Sorry. 2 to the k over 2. Now, this is not, so what we want eigenvalues to be less than 1. When k is large, we are fine. We have some problem with k equal to 0 and k equal to 1. This is unstable, it grows. This is neutral, it doesn't grow. All the rest are stable. Now look at my conditions. I said 0 mean value. So this kills the first unstable direction. The first unstable direction corresponds to average value equal non-zero. So you kill it by this condition. Second condition, normalization of the variance, kills the second one. Of course, you have the whole line of fixed points for the thing. It's not necessarily one coefficient here. You can take any coefficient, but you can fix it by fixing normalization. The rest is stable, so you just prove the theorem that if you start nearby Gaussian, you converge to Gaussian by this procedure, locally. Now, of course, we have much better proofs of the central limit theorem. We know that this result is true globally. But why I started with this example? Because it kind of gives you an idea of what this objects we are talking about will be in dynamics. So it will be some nonlinear transformation in infinite dimensional space of dynamical system. So dynamical system in the space of dynamical system. Here it's dynamical system in space of probability distributions. We'll be looking for some attractors or fixed point or some universal object there, and we'll study their stability. And hopefully we'll try to prove that everything is fine. Now sometimes in dynamics you also have a stable direction corresponding to which you can kill by change of variables. They are not essential, but you don't want to have essential unstable direction, and we'll be talking about this. It's one thing. Secondly, it also shows
Let me clarify things. So you want a normalization which gives you contraction, because some of the most, I would say, important...
Contraction or...
Just a second.
Yeah, okay.
Some of the most important examples of a normalization in dynamics, for example, coming from, say, Rezi induction or something, do not give you a contraction. They give you rather some chaotic dynamics on a finite dimensional set. So that's not what you plan.
Yeah, we'll be talking about it later on, but it's not necessarily contraction. It's a simple, actually in statistical mechanics, the most interesting fixed point, what I describe here, in statistical mechanics, it's more the complicated object. You will not be talking of sum of random variables, you'll be kind of taking random field
right.
And taking sums of blocks and showing that it goes to a limit. Now, you also would have Gaussian trivial, what the physicists would call trivial fixed point. Trivial is not some rude word, it's just the fact that it is simple. And then non-trivial, corresponding to this particular choice of inverse temperature. Mm-hmm. This happens only in the point of phase transition. So you have one unstable direction, and to kill it, you choose a particular value of inverse temperature, meaning that you choose intersection with stable manifold of your fixed point. And then you see contraction.
No, this I understand. I'm
well, in so most cases I will study, you will not have complicated attractors.
Okay.
Okay? So in dynamics it will be mostly convergence. It would be kind of...
No. In dynamics, I'm very sorry, I would say that the induction and other things are central examples of normalization in dynamics, and they are complicated.
Yeah, I'll be talking about...
And they're finite dimensions.
I'll be talking about this, and actually about interval exchanges as well.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Okay. Now, so what I wanted to say, I think it's essential that representation is a very beautiful point of view, ideology. But when you come to concrete proofs, sometimes looking at this micro dynamics, micro sum of these little things is more productive. It gives you better control of what's going on. And of course, it's a very simple theorem. By Fourier analysis, you immediately prove it without any of this ideology, but ideology is here, the whole ideology. Okay. Now, let me move to dynamics immediately and start to discuss dynamical settings. And in dynamics, the real use of representation came first from the work of Mitchell Feigenbaum, which was a big surprise, actually, for the dynamics community, for period doubling verifications. Then people started to study fixed point of corresponding operator. I'm not going to write it. And people like Lanford, they found fixed point for the corresponding operator R. And they found it using computer, it was computer system proof, then people started to prove that spectrum is correct, there is one unstable direction, all the rest is stable. So all this was computer assisted proof. Then it was time to for conceptual proofs of the fact that there is a global convergence, not only local. So going from this analysis to just central limit theorem kind of thing, and this took a long time, and it's a very complicated theory, and it was done. It was done in the work of Sullivan, McMullen, and Lubitsch for interval chain for maps, unimodal maps of the interval. Now then, the theory was extended to circle maps, critical circle maps, and I'll be talking about this. So I'll be concentrated not on interval maps of unimodal maps. I'll be talking only about circle maps because, from my point of view, it's a place where it's easier to explain what transition is and what are the results, and where clean and predictions are clean, and not everything we can prove. But I think we understand a lot of things, but we are not able to prove many. So results which are kind of circle counterpart to McMullen, Sullivan, McMullen, Lubitsch, they are basically De Farie and De Mellor and Jampolsky. And I'll be talking about the thing also. But first I'll introduce what are the ideas of representation in dynamics. So in dynamics, you start with, you replace sums of independent random variables, you replace this n time by iteration of certain map. So basic idea is that you start with certain map and certain space, and it will be one dimensional in my case, and it will be even circle, but then you want to iterate it for long enough time, so iterate it for time say qn, and then you stop at this moment of time, and you look at the system, and you have to choose this time wisely, depending on the dynamics of here, and then you look at your system and you renormalize it, you change scale. You look in a small scale, you rescale it, and that is a rescaled transformation. That is a new transformation you want to start. And then you realize that there is an operator which can, having this one, produce next one, basically. And that is what is called renormalization. Now let me be more concrete and talk about concrete things here. So these QNs, typically in all examples which we are studying, almost all, are times of almost returning a certain point. You choose some mark point on your manifold, and then you move it until point comes very close to its initial position. So the distance will be initial scale to rescale your system, and that's what you do normally. So it is very convenient to discuss such things for circle maps. So considering my M will be a circle, unit circle, and my T will be a homeomorphism, typically diffeomorphism, but maybe it has some singularities, it will have some critical points often. So it's a orientation preserving homeomorphism of a circle, almost diffeomorphism with few singularity points, and we'll assume that rotation number is irrational, which is not so crucial, but let's assume it for simplicity. And then we would think that rotation number has continued fraction expansion, and kn's are integers in continued fraction expansion. So this is continued fraction expansion for this rotation number. Then we know pretty well what does it mean almost come back, because my dynamics is almost rotation, it's rotation by angle rho. It's non-linear rotation, it's not necessarily rotation by angle rho, but it has rotation number rho, so it behaves more or less like rotation. So we know that if we consider Pn over Qn, just truncate my infinite continued fraction at level n, these denominators of Qn would be good times for almost coming back for my system. And in fact, the theory of Poincaré says that the order of points for any homeomorphism of a circle with a rational rotation number will be exactly the same for as for linear rotation, rotation by angle rho. So we know everything about order of the points. And actually, this is a very crucial thing for applications of renormalization in dynamics. That's why in one-dimensional setting it works much better. In one-dimensional case, you have this notion of order of points, combinatorical of the orbits, which is determined by the rotation arm is giving to you, and then you want to study what are the structures which can compatible with the given combinatorial structure. So anyway, I take my circle, and it will be a long circle. I take my marked point x naught, any point in the circle originally, but then we'll choose this maybe more wisely. And then I start to move this point. So I form an orbit of this point. I iterate my map. And at certain time, it would be xqn here, xqn minus 1 there. So the two closest return. If I iterate my system until time qn plus qn minus 1. So until this time, the closest will be this one and that one. There is nothing here and there. I stopped here because at this very moment of time, I'll get a new point just in the middle of this interval somewhere inside, and this will be point xqn plus qn minus 1. But I stopped here. So my plan is to consider induced map. I want not to look at the initial map, I want to see what is the first return map on this interval of my map t. And it's easy to see, and I will not go with it, but it's combinatorical this orbits, and it's basically arithmetical property, that if you take this interval and start to move it with your dynamics, it goes around the circle, never intersects itself, and never intersect images of that one. And the same true about this one, it also will never intersect itself and images of this, and they will cover all the circle. If you rotate this one, which I denote delta 0 n minus 1, if you rotate it until time which is qn, and the other one, in fact, I can rotate only shorter time. J here is less than qn minus 1, previous denominator. So they would cover all the circle. So what it means, that my interval, this interval, the first return will be xqn, this point will come to this one, and this will come to that one. So the whole interval comes here. And this interval will be mapped to this one after qn minus 1 step. So there are naturally defined two maps, and they are very important for me. I would denote them fn, and that is more important map than the other one. So this is a map which takes this interval into that one. So it's exactly map t in power qn, qn iterates of t, but in a renormalized coordinate system. It's up to you how you renormalize this. Traditionally, we renormalize it by taking this being minus 1 and this being 0. So just take this interval as an element of scale and a fine change of variable. I denote this a fine change of variables an as previously. So that's exactly definition of this function or this map, and I did not coordinate that. This is rescaled coordinate. In principle, depends on n. I just don't put this in notation. This is a coordinate from 0 to minus 1 inside this interval. There is another map which takes this one into that one. We denote a gnz. That is less important for me. This is two maps which are renormalized maps. I can forget now about my t. I can work only with those two. And then what will be the renormalization transformation? The renormalization transformation here will be just attempt to go.
When you do this, do you then coordinates out by essentially z with those new coordinates?
Say it again.
You make the interval of x qn minus 1 to x naught just the circle again?
Well, you can. You don't need to do. But you're right. You can consider this small interval as a circle, and you can think this is a circle map. Sometimes it's useful, sometimes it's not. I'm not going to use it now. I look at that maybe as a map of functions f and z and g and z. I'm not using that. You can wrap it up in the circle, but you're right. And so I want to go from this pair to the next pair, fn plus 1, gn plus 1. And that would be exactly my renormalization transformation. Transformation which transform fn, gn into fn plus 1, gn plus 1. And I would define that it will not have any reference to t. Just use this input to calculate the other thing.
So isn't it true that already gives you non-trivial action on rotation, pure rotations, right?
Absolutely. I will stop using Riemann theory, of course. Yeah. So it's true for any homomorphism circle. We haven't used any structure, any smooth structure yet. And so this is a transformation. So what you do? You take, so as I said here, this point would appear first. It will be x qn plus qn minus 1, and 2qn plus qn minus 1, until you come to the very place here, and then you cross on the other side, and then you stop. So this number of steps, if you go this way, will be exactly kn plus 1, which is the next integer continued fraction expansion. But what you don't need to know this integer continued fraction expansion. What you do is the following. You take map fn and start to apply it to minus 1, to point x squared minus 1. And you want to see the time, so you want to see some k such that this is less than 0, but fn k plus 1 of minus 1 is greater than 0. At this moment you stop, and then your new map, fn plus 1, will be equal to gn iterated with fn in power k. That's your new map. And you have to rescale a little bit your coordinate system. And then new map gn plus 1 is just old map fn, which you rescaled with new coordinate system. So that's definition of your rendition operator. And what is this? This is just linear change of variables, because previously we have 0 minus 1 here. Now we're going to have 0 minus 1 there. So it's a short interval, so it's just linear change of variable. So you see, doesn't n is there, but actually you can apply it for any pair f and g. Of course you want fg to be commuting, because otherwise you have a problem. But that's a general confirmation. As Tola said quite rightly, it doesn't matter whether it's diffeomorphism or homeomorphism.
No, that's my comment was not that. My comment was that it already gives you a non-trivial dynamics on the set of rotation numbers.
Yeah.
Or, if you wish, on the set of rotations.
On the set of rotation numbers, it gives you just Gauss map.
Gauss map, exactly.
Gauss map.
And that's a non-trivial dynamic.
It's non-trivial, quite ergodically
quite chaotic, yeah. That was my point.
About which we understand everything.
Oh, sure.
But if you apply this to diffeomorphism of a circle, you also get non-trivial dynamic.
Sure.
Okay, so let me go further. And now I would concentrate on three examples where I will try to see what are the results if you carry on this strategy and you want to study what will be the behavior of this function fn on z when n goes to infinity. So basically what you want to see that in good examples, this fn will depend only on very few features of your map. Basically on rotation number and maybe something else, but very few features. And for most maps, if you do this rendition will get closer and closer. That is the essence of the rendition method. And that's what you hope to prove in some situation. So what will be the situations? The first case is, of course, the simplest one, when t is diffeo. How smooth is a diffeo? For what I'm discussing, it's enough to consider diffeo, which is C2 plus epsilon smooth. That's absolutely enough to the purposes of what I'm discussing. Less will be very bad. I mean, you cannot go beyond lower than C2, but C2 plus epsilon is fine. The second example I'll put here, and the third will be in the middle, because it belongs, I would say, in a certain sense, in the middle. The second example is what is called critical circle maps. And that will be object of study of Impolsky and De Faria de Mello, critical circle maps. So it's counterpart, circle counterpart of Feigenbaum maps, of unimodal maps. It's a map on a circle, or a circle which is smooth everywhere except at one point. So it exists unique critical point. But at this critical point you cannot go down, because at circle map you go up, so it will be an inflection point of certain order. So near this inflection point the map would look like x to the alpha, where this 1 plus alpha is the order of a critical point. So it's just monotone map, like normal circle map, but at one point derivative unfortunately vanishes. And then you have to face consequences. And the third example, and I will motivate why we consider this first third example, it's example of a map with breaks. So it's again map But there exists one point of break such that derivative doesn't vanish at this point, but it kind of different from the left and to the right. So derivative at that point minus is not equal to derivative at this point plus, but they're both positive. So I will describe renormalization results in all three settings, and I will try to explain why we understand everything about this case, a lot about this case, and not so much, I would say, as we would love to about this case. But I specifically wrote here alpha. Of course, the most physically important example of this alpha will be alpha equal to 2, 4, and so on, when this is a kind of analytic map with cubic fifth order, seventh order inflection points. But it can be any alpha. It was discussing, doesn't matter what alpha is. It can be any number positive. I want to keep this, and I erase history. So I promised to say a few words about motivation, why circle maps with breaks are important. I would say the following motivation. So what is a circle map? For people who like Razi induction, like Tolle does, circle map is the interval exchange of two intervals.
No, I don't like
induction. Well, for people who like interval exchanges, this is interval exchange of two intervals.
Yeah, sure.
Right?
Now, the Gauss map is a case of... it's a trivial case of...
It's an interval... So it's an interval exchange of two intervals. It's particular combinatorics,
right,
where you form map of a circle. So you exchange them in particular order. So if you consider interval exchange of n intervals, you still can consider case when they form a circle map. Now, then you have to match n points of these maps because you want to keep continuity. And there is a reason for that. You want to have Dendroit theory. But condition that derivatives match. Now, so I would say that interval exchange maps are linear maps with slope 1. Now, people try to discuss now generalized interval exchange maps, but you replace this slope 1 maps with nonlinear maps. Again, matching of endpoints is important condition if you want to keep topology. Matching of the derivative is not a natural condition. So it's a natural object for interval exchange maps, generalized interval exchange maps, to have maps with breaks. And in fact, this one break is just one example. There is a beautiful, we believe there is a beautiful renormalization theory for maps with finite number of breaks. And then it's not true there is only one unstable direction, there are several unstable directions. And there is a beautiful theory for that, which is now under construction. But we will be going step by step. Now, what is this case? Renormalization theory for this case, this is what is called Riemann theory. I will try to explain that Riemann theory from this point of view is quite a simple object. And then I will give you a proof of Riemann theory to a certain extent. But so from the point of view of renormalization, it would be completely trivial object as a limiting object. Here and here, limiting object will be very non-trivial. But from the point of view of mathematical importance, it's very important to prove that you have interesting behavior or universal behavior for renormalization here. So what are the results? And now I come to kind of rigidity. Rigidity will be next. That will be renormalization conjecture. And it's conjecture because not in all the cases it has been proven, but in many it has been proven. So what do you want to show? You want to show that if you have two different maps, here, here, or here, you start from the same class of maps. So for example, T1, T2 are diffeo. Or T1, T2 are critical circle maps with the same order of critical point. Or this is two maps with breaks with the same break. Now, I haven't said what is the same break. It means that if you change coordinates smoothly, the parameter would not change. There's some invariant of this break. Of course, it's a ratio of this derivative. It wouldn't change. For some reason, it's convenient for us to take square root of this ratio, but it doesn't matter. So that is size of the break, which is not equal to 1. If I consider two meshes with the same C, so in the first case, just any two diffeo, with only condition that rotation number is the same and irrational. In the second case, it would be circle maps with CT1 equal to CT2, and again, the same rotation number. In the third case, alpha T1 is equal to alpha T2. And so what we fix? We fix combinatorics by this condition. And we fix, and actually it's more than combinatorics, but we'll come to this in a moment. And we fix local structure of singular points, or critical points.
And in the first case, there's nothing.
No, nothing. Yeah. This case, nothing. It's different. And what we want to say, that for any two, representation will be converging to each other. They get exponentially close, but then goes to infinity. So we want to conclude that fnz minus fn t and t tilde, fn tilde z, the distance between them in proper norm tends to zero.
So do you assume any kind of Diophantine condition?
Nothing. You don't need one. To assume. You don't need to assume. It's for any rational number. So I'll explain it in a moment. So that's what you want to prove, that you have exponential, so there is number less than one, such which depend on the problem, such that this is exponentially goes to zero when it goes to infinity. You don't need to fix to say about the Diophantine conditions. That's what you want to prove, and that's undoubtedly correct. Now, another thing, we cannot prove it always, but I'll say when we can prove. Now, the Diophantine condition would come when you want to discuss rigidity, when you conclude from this that maps are smoothly conjugate to each other. Then you would very often need the Diophantine condition.
Absolutely.
But this, on this level, it's always true.
Even but you still use irrational rotation.
Irrational rotation. I have to have infinite sequence of this.
Right.
Now, so what is known?
It's global. It converges globally.
It converges globally, yeah. So, in case of diffeomorphism, it's known and it's simple, and I will prove it. So, in the first case, it's a theorem. We'll prove it. And we can even see where it converges. So, we can say that fnz, we know what it approaches, minus an plus z. So it will approach linear map with slope 1 tends to 0 exponentially fast. In fact, very often more than exponentially fast, but at least exponentially fast, where an is a number which is just kn plus 1, kn plus 2, and so on.
What is it, in what norm? Convergence, in what
it
norm?
Depends on how smooth is t, but basically if t has a certain number of derivatives, then you have the same norm here.
So it's just
you not you don't have loss of
regularity.
Yeah, you don't lose regularity here. And I would explain this in a moment. Now, in the second case, it's also another theorem, and we prove the theorem. Well, okay, I have to say a few. It's theorem for a lot of rotation numbers, and it's almost a theorem. I'll put almost a theorem. And I will explain what is known and what is the difference. And in the third case, which is a critical circle case, it's a theorem when alpha is equal to 3, 5, 7, and so on. And that's a result of the melody Fourier and the impulse. And nothing is known for other values of alpha. And that's why we kind of think that this is the most important unsolved problem in rotation. We have phenomena which is true for all alphas, and we have proof of particular values of alpha. It means that we don't understand many things here. So here is a theorem. Non-integer alpha, completely open. Okay, now let me explain this theorem and why it is important for me. I'll say in a moment. Because I want to kind of explain the difference between three situations and what comes there. And here it would be important to remember that the right tool in
probability. So do you understand it correctly? You have fast convergence to the... I'm only considering the top case because the rest I don't have intuition. So you prove that your iterates converge to the linear map, but since saying you are in Liouvillean situation, it doesn't really tell you much, right?
Because it doesn't tell you much about
the small it doesn't rigidity. Converge fast enough
absolutely.
To kill the fast absolutely. Approximation.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I would. Okay.
And if I have time, and I hope I would have time, let me kill this one. Out right here. So remember that it's very often more important not to look at the rotation operator immediately, but to look at the dynamics of these small random variables, of these small intervals. So that's exactly what I want to do. I want to look at the dynamics in a circle of small intervals. It works if I draw my picture kind of smaller, what I have is x naught here, x qn minus 1 there, and if I take the orbit of this interval, it's a very long orbit. It's very long orbit in a circle. They are not intersecting each other, the complement is the orbit of a second interval, which is x qn. And the number of elements of this orbit is qn, so they're very small, exponentially small intervals. It's easy to prove. It follows from Donjon theory. I'm not discussing it, but this is a well-known fact. And there are plenty of them. And we're moving from one to another, right? So we have iteration of maps t acting on this interval. Delta I n goes to delta I plus 1 n. This is not next interval of partition, just some interval which is image of this, and so on. And we do it for AI from 0 to QN. Want to study iteration of these maps. Now, since we have a smooth map on a small interval, everybody knows that smooth map on a small interval is almost linear map, right? It's the whole calculus about that. So it's been told students. So this is an almost linear map. So what it means that it's almost linear map? It means that if I have inside this interval some point and some ratio of interval this and that, then the new ratio which I obtain here will be almost the same as before. Right? So if I have some ratio that ui, the ratio of these two intervals, then goes to ui plus 1, which is almost the same as before. It is ui, but there is corrections to that. And correction will be of the order of the lengths of this interval. Right? For smooth matter. Now if I start to iterate, then I would calculate distortion, how much it will change after I start to iterate. First little, but then little by little, the total result will be product of these terms. And the product of these terms, they're all individual terms are small. So it will be like exponential of the sum of these terms. But the sum of their lengths is order one. So this is something of the order one, I lose control, I cannot say anything about it, so it's not good. But I can save situation. Instead of ratio, I will consider two points. So they divide it on two intervals, A, B, C. And I consider cross ratio, which is A over A plus B times C over C plus B. Cross ratio of two points. Then, instead of U, I will have this cross ratio, going to cross ratio, and then there's a little miracle, but it's very easy calculation, and every student can do it, it's completely elementary, that this preserves also, but up to the second order. In fact, it preserved up to the second order if you have three derivatives. It will be preserved up to the order 1 plus epsilon if you have 2 plus epsilon derivatives. But that saved me completely, because then the total distortion will be given by this in power 1 plus epsilon. And this number is small, because sum of deltas is 1, order 1, and all individuals are small. So this is exponentially small sum. And I know that my cross ratio preserves up to exponentially small correction. Now the map which preserves cross ratio is a linear fractional map. So I know that my resulting map, TQN, in rescaled coordinate, is close linear fraction to Möbius transformation. and I get it for nothing. So I started with infinite dimensional map, space of maps. And under transition, I know that I converge to finite dimensional space of fractional linear transformation. I want to prove more. I want to prove that they're in fact linear and with slope 1. So I have to do a little bit more, but that's an important step. I'm already in finite dimensional situation. Now, how to save this? Let me explain why this fractional linear map is in fact linear map. And then you will believe me that slope should be 1 because circle goes to circle, so it must be 1. Remember I said, consider not cross ratios, but ratios. Zi. Zi plus 1 was equal to Zi times 1 plus terms of the order of lengths of the interval. Let me be more careful. What is this thing? This is second derivative of my map divided by 2 times first derivative. At any point, I can calculate it at any point of interval, doesn't matter, times delta I plus higher order terms. That's correction. So that is the first order correction. So what is this? This is integral. You can think about this small term as an integral of second derivative of 2 times first derivative dx over my interval delta I n. So basically, when I calculate final change of ratio, I have to take sum of all these terms. So I take integrals over these yellow intervals, and I want to say that this is small. And the reason for that, that it's easy to show that these intervals are uniformly distributed on the whole circle in a very strong sense. So the total sum of these integrals, there is a density of these integrals, of these intervals. So the total sum, and this is easy as exercise, that this total sum of the integrals of these derivatives over that, over delta I n, I from 0 to qn minus 1, will be basically equal to density of these intervals times integral of the whole circle. Where is this density? But this integral is equal to 0 because it's full derivative. So you're in different of this situation. This is 0. So that's why the whole sum is close to 0. So that in fact you cannot have singularity. Now, this argument will tell you that map is close to linear map with slope 1. It will not give you the best possible estimate for how close it is.
Why did you use that it was Lewis? You don't use it?
I'm not using here. I'm not using that it's Möbius. It's kind of incorporated.
In fact, at the beginning, you
it is incorporated. Yeah. Möbius will be essential for second case, for this case, because here it's really Möbius. And so that's proof that it is in fact linear, and then slope must be 1. Now this doesn't give you the best possible estimate, but in fact, if you use this idea,
best question, what on speed of convergence?
On the speed of convergence, because to say that they are uniformly distributed, you used to use some kind of ergodic theorem on the distribution of thermodynamic formalism type, and that gives you exponential rate of convergence, but not with no control of the exponent. You can do better than that, and the result which you'll obtain will be the following result, and I'll formulate it to the theorem. But before I have to say one word, so all what we're doing here, this randomization convergence results, are used for the third word, which I wrote on the blackboard but haven't explained it, which is called rigidity. So what rigidity is about? We know that all maps we are considering topologically conjugate to simple rotation. That is Donjoua theorem for first and second situation. For third situation, theorem of your course. It's less trivial, but it's still the fact. But all maps we are considering, for them it's true that there is a change of variable, which is a homeomorphism of the circle, the topological level, such that this map is conjugate to a linear rotation, topologically. And then natural question in case of diffeomorphism is to ask whether you can do this smoothly. So that's rigidity. You know that something a priori is only topologically conjugate, you won't conclude that they're smoothly conjugate. The same in other two stations, but then you cannot conjugate, of course, to pure rotation because it's not a good idea. You have to take two maps, they're topologically conjugate to each other, you ask whether there is a smooth conjugation between them. whether you can get rigidity result. And I formulate rigidity result in the first case, and this is our theorem which we announced first with Sinai, and then there was some kind of little problem there. We fix it with Alexei Teplinsky. It's a paper published now, and this is me and Teplinsky. And it gives the following result. So as I said, T belongs to class C2 plus epsilon. Rotation number is Diophantine d delta. And that means that such rotation number that for any P and Q, PQ minus rho is greater or equal than constant, which depends on rho, divided by Q to the power 2 plus delta. This is a full measure set of rotation numbers called Diophantine plus d delta. So if we assume that epsilon is greater than delta, then we can show that conjugation phi will be in fact class C1 plus epsilon minus delta. So this is a positive number, so you're more than C1 conjugate. So you don't have
rigidity. This is an improvement on Ornstein
constant. It's improvement on Ornstein constant. Yes.
The basic result of that kind is
Ornstein constant. Ornstein constant subtracts something here, we don't need to subtract it.
Okay.
Now this theorem is proving in compared to Omri on 5 or 6 pages, and this is complete proof and completely elementary. But this theorem is basically this type of result for typical numbers was kind of conjectured by Arnold in the paper of 61 and took Ehrman maybe 20 years to fix it. So the first result was Ehrman of 76 who proved this type of result, and your course and others. Now there are a variety of results for different smoothness classes. They're going up in smoothness, they may be more complicated.
Well, for the Yorkos theorem, you still don't have a 5-page proof.
This is a basic result.
You don't have a 5-page.
And this is 5 pages result. And kind of idea of rotation are useful here. Now, what's going on in other two situations? In other two situations, you have a singular point. So I'll treat both cases simultaneously. So again, you have point x naught. Now you have to choose x naught properly. For critical circle maps, you choose this critical point as a marked point. For breakpoint case, you choose x break as a starting point. And then again, you have these orbits getting closer and closer here. And again, you have dynamics of these intervals. But what happens is that these intervals, you have the same relation when you're outside, not close to critical point. So for example, if you're far from breakpoint, or not covering breakpoint, you exactly have the same situation. But sometimes you cover breakpoint, and then it changes your scales. But then you go for a long time when you don't change it. And then you come again and change it. And the same is here, but only you change your scale when you come not only to this, but close to it. But most of the time you're outside of this critical point, but sometimes you come. So there's kind of local corrector, which corrects your scale, the time you came here. And you want to see, and you can calculate how it corrects. If you know positions, you know what will be the new scaling, because you know that power here is x, x to the alpha. So you can calculate depending on alpha what will happen. And what you want to say is that there is only one order of these points which is consistent with this alpha. And the one, not even order, one metrical sequence of these points which consistent with this alpha is number C, which is ratio of derivatives, and rho. So if you fix rho, alpha, and C, there is no choice. I mean, your sequence will be automatically such and such. So there is kind of strong convergence which you want to prove. And again, outside of critical point, you know everything. When you come closer, but then you have the fact that the farther away you're from critical point, then the effect is slower and slower. Okay. Now, as I said, this kind of consideration is not used in the theory of Yampolsky, de Mello, de Faria. They use complex analytical methods. It's not used. And maybe because of that, it is not solved for different alphas. I strongly believe that this is a real analytical problem, but many, many experts would disagree with me.
Yes, it's what?
This is problem is real analytic rather than a complex analytic problem for different alphas. But in case of C, break singularity, we managed to construct complete theory of renormalizations with Teplinsky. And the result is the following. Yes, in this case, as in the previous case, the maps are fracture linear maps, but they're indeed fracture linear maps. But they would depend on two parameters.
And the renormalization transformation will act in a space of these two parameters, and then it's very non-trivial transformation.
It's a counterpart of Razi induction.
Well, it is non-linear part of Razi induction, because Razi induction is done for linear maps with slope 1.
No, but it acts on the set, on the invariant set, to which everything converges.
Yeah,
right?
But I want to emphasize that what is in Razi induction, you always deal with map with slope 1, with linear maps with slope 1.
That's not essential.
Yeah, it is very essential. And here you use with a map with a fractional linear map.
No, I understand that, yeah. But
so
still
it's
finite
extension. It's kind of extension of Razi induction. It's relation. Well, it's extension of Razi induction. It's true, and we believe that we can construct complete transition theory for any number of breaks. But it's important that it's circle map. Combinatorics is such of this interval chain that this is circle map. But in case of one break, complete theory is
constructed. I don't understand. If you take an arbitrary interval exchange on the interval, you can just artificially say that it's on the circle, and that simply means that.
Okay.
So, why are you emphasizing that?
I would emphasize that because of the following reason. So, suppose you want to prove the following result. You want to say two interval exchanges are smoothly conjugate to each other. Okay. Now, you first have to say that they are topologically conjugate to each other.
Sure.
It's not true generally. So there is no de Jouy theory for interval exchanges, unfortunately. There are counterexamples to it. No, there are counterexamples to it, real counterexamples. So it's really not conjugate topologically. So when you're in a circle, you have de Jouy theory, so they are topologically. You don't need to repeat as a mantra, if they are topologically conjugate, which you never know, then they may be smoothly conjugate. So what we are proving here is the following, that if you have interval exchange in a circle, so this map is few breaks, and then if the sizes of breaks are the same for all points, rotation.
Oh, the sizes of breaks are the same for it. Well, this is a condition.
The sizes of breaks.
I didn't catch.
Yeah, the sizes of breaks must be the same.
Okay, sure.
Rotation number must be the same.
Yeah, then it's of
and
course.
And what also must be the same, the invariant measure between breaks must be the same for both maps.
Okay.
Then they're smoothly conjugate. So this gives you number of unstable directions needed for this thing. And so there is a renormalization theory for that, which is under construction. And there are some mystery going on there. There are some symmetries. In fact, there is some symplectic structure, which is reminiscence of the symplectic structure for Razi, but it's going up. It's in a different space and still survives the symplectic structure there. And that's what we're working on with Stiplinski, and once we are going to mention Elio Maseo, who is present here, and Sasha Kosic. I was not able to formulate all the results, but that is flavor of what's going on in renormalization and what we want to achieve. Thank you.
Forgive me if this doesn't make any sense, but my vague understanding of Aubrey matter theory is that you kind of glue together a bunch of circles with morphisms to get a cylinder with the morphisms. I'm wondering if you can kind of renormalize those maps as we're doing a continuous version of what it looks like.
So forgive me if I didn't understand completely what you're saying. If you're talking about invariant curves for twist maps and then circle homomorphism or diffeomorphism arising from that, then this is relevant, very relevant, and you can construct these curves using a renormalization, but this will be two-dimensional renormalization because you're living in a city. But such things exist. There is a renormalization approach to KM theory in higher dimensions. And you can do this. There is also hope to construct non-trivial fixed point corresponding to last curves, the curves which are not KM curves, but before destruction. There is a last curve which is not smooth anymore. So it's smooth, but not analytic. And then there's non-trivial fixed point organization, which numerically you can see, but the theory is too complicated at the moment. There are no good results to be there.
I would say it's been a hope for quite a while.
Hans Kohl,
and it's still a hope.
It still doesn't work quite. And it is very non-trivial fixed points. We are still dealing with simple case of one critical point, which we don't understand. In this case, there is whole orbit of kind of singularities, and this is much harder. But it is relevant.
Really. Any more questions?
Yeah. Any hope of building the renormalization theory for that move?
Well, I mean,
Can you actually formulate your question? Because type Muller is a renormalization flow. For non-linear.
Yeah. For non-linear. We're trying to build this theory on a circle. They're non-linear, they're not general, but they're on a circle. Now, we cannot use Razi. Razi is too bad. And Tony was right that he's not a big fan of it. It's too or arbitrary. But there are better, more symmetric versions of Razi, of similar induction, which work on a circle, and that's what we work with. There are combinatorial questions which are difficult. It's possible, but I think
is a collection of requirements, like you have in the break.
I think you should have some topological restrictions. Not in all the cases you build up a good theory, but I'm not sure. As I said, the Dunjua theory is not always true for them, for intervention, but sometimes it is true. I don't know.
No, but I would like to actually make a comment, because in two, I would say, parts of dynamics community, word normalization has different emphasis. So the general picture is like that. You have some infinite dimensional space, and you have an operator which takes your complicated objects and kind of bring it to a small subset. And then this normalization operator also acts on this small subset. And that's also normalization, right? So Gauss map, Razi induction, Teichmuller flow, for certain section of dynamical community, are renormalization operators acting, but for you, the most important part is to take a big space and bring it back and then see what's... So this is a little bit of the use of the same thing in two different... I mean, it's just two different parts of the story, right?
Yeah, you could say it.
Yeah, it's two different parts of the story. And in certain cases, even in a standard case, even for unimodal maps, the dynamics of unimodal maps are extremely interesting already at the combinatorial level. But what Feigenbaum tells you is that all families of unimodal maps, at least not too far from the say standard one, behave the same way, right?
Yeah, metrical universal.
Yeah. So that's a kind of universality which I think you were talking about.
What I want to say that as long as you stay in a world of linear things, you don't see critical phenomena. You don't see critical points and non-trivial fixed point corresponding to critical phenomena. And that is what is a kind of very non-trivial part of the theory. So, but I agree, the other part is also interesting, but it's what I said, this was trivial fixed point, this is non-trivial. And you see it only in a linear world where you have critical points.
Okay. I have a historical question. You refer to this as a hypercapture of Arnold from 61. Of course, Arnold pulled the local theorem and asked about global, but didn't he only speak about analytic maps?
Yes, his paper was exactly about
analytic maps. No, but his conjecture or whatever he asked was also about analytic maps.
I don't think he thought this way. Just the paper was written for analytic maps because at that time, KM theory existed only for analytical theory.
Sure.
But I think Arnold understood that analyticity there here is not crucial. I think so. But yes, it's for conjecture.
Well, you're making a statement, because I remember the fuzz in Moscow when Moser paper arrived. You weren't around, but I was already there. There was a big fuzz.
Well,
how come that you
then
can
I have counter comment?
Yeah, without analyticity.
It's a very interesting thing that indeed it was a big fuss in Moscow when Moser's paper arrived because it was without analyticity. But Moser actually tried to prove theory for analytic setting and failed.
Yeah, sure.
And he published this because it's what he was able to do.
Sure.
So he thought it's a shortcoming of his theory. And in Moscow it was considered as a big, big advantage.
Yeah, sure.
And it's true. So it's kind of.
Yeah, I can also quote my paper with Hasselblad about Moser's achievements, which discuss all this in detail.
Yeah, it's very interesting that
sure.
we see as a main achievement of Moser, he thought it is shortcoming.
Sure. That's well known. Okay, so I think we then.
Do you just want to show it?
What?
So there are no phase transitions here? What would be phase transitions in that context?
What would be phase transitions?
Because I don't know basically what is phase transition.
Phase transition, I would say that in statistical mechanics,
to cancel to
you have this random fields which are very simple when beta is large, and kind of very understood when beta is small, and then at point of transition you have non-trivial fixed point of transition, non-trivial behavior.
So what is a fixed?
So here, okay. So maybe I will say, yeah, it's a good question. So. In order to say that things have the same transition, we have to fix rotation number. So fixing of rotation number is like fixing of the critical temperature. And it also gives you that the set of critical circular members with the same rotation number has a structure of manifold, because this is a stable manifold of hyperbolic fixed point. Otherwise, it's very difficult to say what is the structure of this of the space of critical diffeomorphism or any with giving rotation number. It's infinite number of inequalities, but it's manifold, not, it's not trivial at all. In fact, it's a manifold, it's a stable manifold for this fixed point. So the you fix...
Wait, but it's only for the phantom.
So temperature is the rho.
No, I'm sorry.
Say it again.
Temperature is rho?
Temperature is rho, yes.
No, but I'm confused. It's only for the phantom that it's a smooth manifold.
Well, I mean...
How
will get, of course not.
And for Newvillian, it's
yeah,
like
of course,
this.
For rational rotation number, you have to put some different condition, but how, otherwise, without this, I don't know how to prove the smoothness of this manifold. Without understanding this stable manifold of a certain hyperbolic fixed point.
I think it's up from Hermann, maybe a priori, since it's,
I don't know.
Since it's conjugate.
I don't know. I think it's just coming from...
It's certainly a very nice way to put it.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, I think we're running short on time, so. So the next talk is in.